Church this Wednesday evening, 7 p.m. Those of you watching online, you can follow the full service on our website, trinityscarsdale.org/bulletin. Follow the whole service. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and peace at the house. Amen. It is good to give thanks for the Lord, to sing praise to your name on the Most High, to herald your love in the morning, your truth at the close of the day.
We sing hymn 915 from the Lutheran Service Book. Today, Your Mercy Calls Us, in 915. And then again from the Gospel according to John, chapter 14, verse 27. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you've turned again, strengthen your brothers. Peter said to him, Lord, I'm ready to go both to prison and to death with you. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow this day until you deny three times that you know me. When they had seized Jesus and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house, Peter followed at a distance. And when they kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. And a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the light and looking closely at him, said, this man was also with him. But he denied it, saying, woman, I don't know him. And a little later, someone else saw him and said, you also are one of them. But Peter said, man, I am not. And after an interval of about an hour, still another insisted, saying, certainly this man was also with him, for he too is a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I do not know what you're talking about. And immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the saying of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And so Peter went out and wept bitterly. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid.
Into your hands, O Lord, I come and my spirit. Into your hands I come.
Service book, Jesus, I Will Ponder Now, 440.
Yeah.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God, our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, who went to the cross for us, who shed his blood as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the whole world, your sin, my sin, who rose from the dead, as our first hymn of the day said, giving us the crown of righteousness forever, to live with him in eternal blessedness. This is most certainly true. So let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, our Rock and Redeemer. Amen. Continuing our Lenten overall theme, life and death in the garden tonight, particularly denied. We've moved to the garden of the high priest, where Jesus has been brought for his trial. It's an awkward time of the day, but it's legitimate. All the necessary authorities in their own eyes are there. Peter has followed at a distance. He said to Jesus, I'll never leave you. But he follows at a distance because all the disciples, as we heard last week, left and fled when he was arrested, when he was betrayed. And tonight we're going to hear all about how Peter betrays Jesus again by denying he's even a disciple. He's already betrayed him. He's fled the scene. As if that weren't enough, now he outwardly denies him. Vocally. Man, I don't know what you're talking about. I never knew him. I want to talk a little bit, perhaps, about different types of denial. How we can actually be in denial. How sometimes we can be denying a truth without even really being conscious of it, knowing it. But it's such a shock to the system, maybe emotionally, psychologically, that we are actually in denial. We can't even admit how horrific the situation is to ourselves. So maybe we can ask this question. Was Peter in denial? Maybe he couldn't even believe himself what he was doing. Or would that be an excuse? You know, when you think about how some people even commit murder, right? And maybe sometimes they can get away with the insanity plea. And they're somehow out of their right mind. Is there a case there about them being in denial about what they've done? When you think about it, when something as horrific as even murder takes place, a lot of people are still with it. That's kind of a scary thought as well. They can't deny it, because they've done it. The evidence is there. They can't deny what they've done. And that isn't the same as feeling sorry for what they've done as well. The best way to make us feel sorry for what we've actually done is to shame us. To point the truth out. To point out the truth of our sin. So that we can repent of it. Not be in denial of it, but repent of it to be forgiven. How can we be forgiven if we're in denial of our sin? Which is really what gets me sometimes. When pastorally I get down to the bottom of someone's sin. And they don't even deny it. But will say, I don't even remember doing that. That's being in denial. And it's their only excuse. And it's dangerous because it's more healthy to admit your sin. Don't deny your sin. That's even one of the ways we put it in one of our forms of confession and absolution. Don't deny your sin. How can the truth remain in you if you deny your sin? Or that you are a sinner? My goodness, this is something really does happen horrific to you. Or you've done something horrific to such a degree where you are emotionally scarred and you're in denial. I pray that would never be the case. But that would be the only way that you might be excused from your sin. Because you're so out of it, you can't even recognize how evil you are. There may be an element of Peter being in denial here. Until he comes back to his senses. And the Lord still can bring us back to our senses even when we do. Or may sadly initially have that kind of state of mind. But again, it's different to denying sin outright when you know you've done wrong. May you never be consciously unrepentant when you know you're a sinner and a sin. I don't even think that was the sin of Judas when he went and hung himself. He did the wrong thing. He may have even been repentant, but was so full of despair that that's where that took him. But at least he wasn't in denial. We don't really deny good things, do we? It's usually negative things. Like when we suspect we might be found out. So we might initially deny that we've done it. Hopefully, if you have a wise parent, they quickly bring you to your senses and show you that they know you've done wrong and bring you to forgiveness. It takes a really humble person to deny something for goodness sake. Oh, I'm not that good. I can be in denial that way too. You ever see those rooster weather vanes? I think they're really clever, and they always remind me of this narrative where Peter denies Jesus and the rooster crows. Why a weather vane? Because that's how fickle the wind is. That's how quickly the wind can change. So you have these weather vanes that show the direction of the wind. I think that's true. It's nature. And it speaks of how quickly one can make a confession, a good confession of faith in Jesus, almost as quickly deny him. Because that's who we are by nature. We have this sinful side to us. By the grace of God, may that wind change again. If you notice, but in Greek, it's the same word for spirit as wind. Not that the spirit is as random as wind. But perhaps that's how quickly the Lord can change our hearts and minds when we see the truth. That he wants to forgive us. not so that we could be in denial of our sin, but so that we would turn to him and deny sin. That sin would no longer be in control of who we are. Deny sin. Not in a way that we deny sin exists, or deny that we ever have sinned, but that the Lord would strengthen us once more as we turn to him for forgiveness, admitting that we're sinners. Turn us around as easily as one of those weather vanes. Next time you see one of those rooster weather vanes, think of this. And so we could ask us equally, did Peter's loyalty to Jesus really change? It didn't, did it? Yes, he denied Jesus vocally. What did he do after he realized that's what he was doing? He went and wept bitterly. Immediately. And that's what the Spirit causes a believer to do when they've seen that they've sinned. Right away. Lord, forgive me of my sin. I won't deny my sin. I won't be in denial over my sin. I am a sinner. Forgive me. The Spirit changed my heart quickly. Back to you, Jesus. Do you imagine being able to actually look it in the eyes? What a horrific moment that would have been when he denied him three times. He knew what he was thinking. But Peter was still loyal to Jesus. But he makes this confession out of fear. Every day of our lives, we may have reason to fear something or other, and to remind us again of our original condition. But what did Jesus say in John 14 again? Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. What good news that is. We have to put that on the end of any one of these passages that remind us of our original condition. That by our restored status before God through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we can now stand up tall and not wallow in the muck or worry about whether or not we're living in denial. Again, Peter was immediately repentant. He wept bitterly. What would have happened if Peter was not repentant? I think about this. The fruit of unbelief, if you will, would have been the natural course of action for someone who sins and doesn't believe in a Lord and Savior. But he does turn back to God. And then, of course, we're brought to mind after Jesus' resurrection. Yeah, this is a while later now. After he's risen from the dead. And it's as if Peter confronts, Jesus confronts Peter with this threefold denial of his name vocally. Feed my sheep. Jesus says to Peter after he's risen from the dead. This is clear evidence that the right way to approach any sin pastorally is to point it out, for repentance and forgiveness. Clearly, that we're not to hide our sin, or ever even forget about it in a way that we don't deal with it. Think, well, time will just take care of it. After enough time, I can just forget about it. Jesus deals with our sin. And he would remind us of it in order to remove it, to deal with it, to forgive it. Of course, Peter's direct interaction with Jesus is so powerful. Again, in its immediate instance, he just looks at him after the rooster crows, and then after, in a threefold pattern, similar to the denial, shows him that he is restored, that he is forgiven of that sin particularly. Of course, he can't help but think of his own sin of denying him. When Jesus asks him three times, "Do you love me?" he's brought to tears again. Tears of joy, I would imagine, knowing that he is able to carry on, to move forward, having been forgiven. And it's something we do have to keep asking ourselves. Do I love Jesus now? Am I in denial of my sin? Lord, give me strength. Remind me of your suffering and passion for me, that you went to the cross for me, that you rose from the dead, thereby forgiving me my sin and restoring me to live for you and for my neighbor. One doesn't simply change direction like the weather vane and go one way, hopefully positively, from going in a negative direction, but because they specifically deal with their sin and not deny it. For if you don't repent, you may be in that first category of denial. You may be in denial. We are to admit that we're sinners, and maybe even to particular sins if they are on our conscience. And that's a whole other concept in itself. I mean, if it's on your conscience, my goodness, repent of it, so that you may be forgiven and the truth may reside in you. I should probably mention something about St. Patrick, seeing as it is St. Patrick's Day. If you don't know the history, he was an Englishman, actually. One of these rich Englishmen who had estates in Ireland, so probably an early version of tax evasion, came over to Ireland to live in one of his estates one year, and he was kidnapped by the Irish because they came, and barbarians that they are, and pillaged his estate and imprisoned him for 6 years, where he found religion. Somehow managed to escape his Irish prison, came back to England, because he found a religion, went to a monastery and studied Christianity for 15 years, and then decided, because he got a vision, of course, that he'd come back to Ireland to be a missionary to the Irish. He spent some time there, had estates there, etc., and won well. And what he's famous for then is actually being able to use the culture, the Irish culture, hand in hand with Christianity in order to relate to the people really well. Obviously, a lot of people will use that and interpret that as being a man of the people and would probably drink with them, etc. But of course, what he did was latch on to the common mythologies and superstitions of the day, and of course they worshipped the sun. So he was really good at taking a piece of culture and then taking a Christian symbol. And actually, what may look like him combining the two, actually, as we would explain it in Christianity, and probably the most positive way possible is actually by combining these symbols, we're saying that actually Christianity superseded it, so that whatever happened before was now no longer in redundant. So this is the Celtic cross was formed because St. Patrick took the worship of the sun, which is basically the easiest way to picture that the sun symbolically is a circle, and so the Celtic cross is a cross with a circle in the middle of it. So that's the Celtic cross, and as people would usually explain it, it's a circle, so it's the symbol for eternity, and of course eternity goes with God and Jesus and the cross. But actually, it was an attempt by St. Patrick to relate the common folk to Christianity, and so if you're going to worship something, worship the cross. And so he put the sun, the symbol for the sun, on the cross, and that is the Celtic cross. But not to say we worship the sun and Jesus, but probably to play on that onomatopoeic saying, the sun, S-U-N, is no longer to be worshipped, but the sun, S-O-N, is to be worshipped, the one who, of course, went to the cross. And so he just put the sun on the cross. Metaphorically, God does describe himself as, if you will, the sun of the world, right? The light of the world. It is a great metaphor for God. You can't look at the sun directly without going blind. It is too magnificent to look at. So St. Patrick takes this and says, worship the Son of God who died for your sins on the cross. And so he puts the sun on the cross because that's what we should be focusing on. Not to worship the sun, but to worship Jesus, the Son of God, S-O-N. Similar to the idea, by the way, of the fact that we still celebrate the resurrection of the Lord, the most important doctrine in Christianity, when? At Easter time. Do we celebrate the goddess Ishtar of fertility and sex? No, that's not mentioned at all at Easter time. The only thing we talk about is the resurrection of Jesus. Why do we combine, or what looks like we're combining these concepts? Because we're saying Jesus is to be worshipped. And he completely takes over the celebration of Ishtar, the goddess. And of course, again, we never even mention that concept. We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus at Easter. And there is no other celebration but Jesus alone, who is Lord and Savior, risen from the dead, having died for our sins on the cross. That trumps everything. Always. To compare that to what St. Patrick did, we worship Jesus Christ alone. Not the Son. But he made a cool Celtic cross out of it. What do we do today to reach out, to outreach, to evangelize to the people out there in the world, to communicate the message of our Lord and Savior? We're living in more of a sort of atheistic age these days, so people just go to the pub and they're not celebrating the man who brought Christianity to the heathen and Irish, which
having a good time and a drink with your few. We can do that too. We can relate to our neighbour and say, well, we can be in the world, not necessarily of it to the point of getting ridiculously drunk. That's a sin, obviously. But drinking isn't a sin. We can show that we are normal people as Christians, that we have very normal hope and faith in a God who went to the cross for us to suffer for us, because that is what we deserve. Whether or not we get drunk, whether or not we're more violent or have violent tendencies than our neighbor, whether or not we're faithful to our spouses, or a little promiscuous, whether or not we're swindlers, peddlers, or just thieves, or daylight robbers, whether or not we covet everything of our neighbor, or believe that we are content, because God has given us our lot. Jesus' death and resurrection is for all of us, because we all need this salvation. None of us are perfect, which is what God demands. And Jesus is that perfection for us. May we come back to him again and again. Ritualistically, routinely, come to a place like this. Or if you're not here, thankfully here online. But you need him. You need him to strengthen our faith, which hopes in something more than I can produce by my best efforts. Let me try to fool my neighbor into thinking that I'm a good person, I'm a good Christian. If I did that, I would be in denial. I would be denying that I'm a sinner. I'd be like Peter, who, to get along with someone who I just wanted to warm myself with by the fire, denied my Lord and Savior. We all need Jesus to save us. Being a Christian isn't being a better person out in the world. That would be a hypocritical concept. To be a Christian is to know I need Jesus, and to come routinely to a place that reminds me of that. To simply not be in denial, but know I have a Savior, thanks be to God, through my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who will continue to strengthen my faith in this place and give me hope for everlasting life. In his name and for his sake, amen. May the peace which surpasses our understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cry. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. In righteousness I shall see you. When I awake, your presence will give me joy. how bake we in watch with crumbs, and asleep we may rest in peace. Oh, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. Now your own eyes have seen our salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every evil. A light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the
merciful God, and protect us through the hours of this night, so that we who are weary by the changes and chances of life may find our rest in you. Support us all the day long of this troubled life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed. The fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in your mercy keep us safe as we rest, and give us peace at the last. Be our light in the dark, O Lord, and in your great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of your only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God, the Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you now and forevermore. Amen.